In the year 51 AD, in Corinth, Paul's work, his mission, his very life rested in the hands of the Romans. Accused by pious Jews of preaching against the faith, Paul now faced the possibility of torture and death. An anxious Paul looked to his Lord for comfort, and God came to him in a serene vision of encouragement.
Do not be afraid, but speak, and do not be silent, for I am with you, and no one shall attack you to harm you, for I have many people in this city.
But would Paul truly survive the wrath of his earthly opponents? On the day of his trial, Paul found himself standing before the Bema, the seat of judgment. There, under the glare of the mighty tribunal, Paul listened as the angry Jews made their case, saying,
"This man is persuading men to worship God contrary to the law."
When the accusations were finished, Paul began his defense. But the proconsul stopped the apostle mid-sentence, and the text of Acts records the tribunal's judgment.
"Since it is a matter of questions about words and names and your own law, see to it yourselves."
This religious controversy was of no interest to Rome, and the matter was quickly dismissed. Some believe God was watching over Paul after all. Paul no longer felt safe in Corinth, so he returned to Antioch. From there, in the year 54, he began a third missionary journey, this time traveling northwest to Asia Minor and the city of Ephesus. In the first century, Ephesus was the capital of the wealthy Roman province of Asia, in what is now western Turkey. Mere ruins now, ancient Ephesus was once a center of banking, commerce, government, and religion. One of the major centers of the Roman world. This city, the gateway to the entire province, gave Paul a strategic pulpit from which to spread God's word.
During the years that Paul spent in Ephesus, he did not cease evangelizing the other areas around. He formed other evangelists, those who would bear the gospel, to go up into the valley and that area.
Day after day, Paul taught in a large lecture hall. According to the text of Acts, the entire province eventually came to hear Paul speak. And there was more. Through God, Paul performed healing miracles.
Handkerchiefs or aprons were carried away from his body to the sick. And diseases left them. And the evil spirits came out of them.
Paul's powerful words and persuasive deeds helped win many converts. Even local sorcerers turned away from their black arts. But for Paul, success was never free of potential disaster. In Ephesus, Paul received distressing reports. Some Christian communities were foundering. In Corinth, a variety of moral and social issues were tearing apart the congregation. Sexual temptation, drunkenness at worship service, divorce, civil litigation. In a letter to church members, Paul strove to strengthen their faith by reminding them of the danger to be found in dissension.
"Do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy that person.
What he's saying is that the unity of the church is more important than any of these things that are dividing you. Unity in the ancient world and in the modern world, in the eyes of many as well, is bought at the price of submission of some persons to the higher good.
Then, in what has become his most famous passage, Paul poetically described the supreme Christian value, love.
Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends.
Eventually, Paul's words tame the savage beasts that threaten to tear his followers apart. Paul would stay and teach in Ephesus for 2 years, longer than any single place. And his impact on the early Christians there was immense. A mountaintop overlooking Ephesus. Inside, a grotto dating from perhaps as early as the 4th century. For ages, the interior of this cave has remained unseen to all but a handful of archaeologists. Now it is revealed to the world. Sometime in the 6th century, an unknown Christian pilgrim memorialized a popular Christian legend on the cave wall. The faded painting depicts the story of Paul and Thecla, a female student with tremendous admiration for Paul's work.
In fact, Thecla becomes so enraptured that she decides to follow Paul's teaching. We have Thecla, who, after being converted by Paul, cuts her hair like a man's, dresses up in a man's robe, and goes off from town to town preaching the gospel just like Paul does.
The image of Paul staring straight at us bespeaks of a fiery passion within, potent evidence of the apostle's inner power and the near supernatural impression he made on the people of Ephesus. But again, Paul's victories teetered on the edge of defeat. By the year 57, Paul's success in Ephesus began to provoke fierce opposition. But this time, the problem wasn't Judeo-Christian conflict. The problem was money. A marshy plain just outside of Ephesus. Here, a vast marble temple stood in tribute to Artemis, pagan goddess. Christian conflict. The problem was money. A marshy plain just outside of Ephesus. Here, a vast marble temple stood in tribute to Artemis, pagan goddess.
ancient world and in the modern world in the eyes of many as well, is bought at the price of submission of some persons to the higher good.
Then, in what has become his most famous passage, Paul poetically described the supreme Christian value, love.
Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends.
Eventually, Paul's words tame the savage beasts that threatened to tear his followers apart. Paul would stay and teach in Ephesus for 2 years, longer than any single place. And his impact on the early Christians there was immense. A mountaintop overlooking Ephesus. Inside, a grotto dating from perhaps as early as the 4th century. For ages, the interior of this cave has remained unseen to all but a handful of archaeologists. Now it is revealed to the world. Sometime in the 6th century, an unknown Christian pilgrim memorialized a popular Christian legend on the cave wall. The faded painting depicts the story of Paul and Thecla, a female student with tremendous admiration for Paul's work.
In fact, Thecla becomes so enraptured that she decides to follow Paul's teaching. We have Thecla, who, after being converted by Paul, cuts her hair like a man's, dresses up in a man's robe, and goes off from town to town preaching the gospel, just like Paul does.
The image of Paul staring straight at us bespeaks of a fiery passion within, potent evidence of the apostle's inner power and the near supernatural impression he made on the people of Ephesus. But again, Paul's victory. Paul now faced the possibility of torture and death. An anxious Paul looked to his Lord for comfort, and God came to him in a serene vision of encouragement.
Do not be afraid, but speak, and do not be silent, for I am with you, and no one shall attack you to harm you, for I have many people in this city.
But would Paul truly survive the wrath of his earthly opponents? On the day of his trial, Paul found himself standing before the Bema, the seat of judgment. There, under the glare of the mighty tribunal, Paul listened as the angry Jews made their case, saying,
"This man is persuading men to worship God contrary to the law."
When the accusations were finished, Paul began his defense. But the proconsul stopped the apostle mid-sentence, and the text of Acts records the tribunal's judgment.
"Since it is a matter of questions about words and names and your own law, see to it yourselves."
This religious controversy was of no interest to Rome, and the matter was quickly dismissed. Some believe God was watching over Paul after all. Paul no longer felt safe in Corinth, so he returned to Antioch. From there, in the year 54, he began a third missionary journey, this time traveling northwest to Asia Minor and the city of Ephesus. In the first century, Ephesus was the capital of the wealthy Roman province of Asia in what is now Western Turkey. Mere ruins now, ancient Ephesus was once a center of banking, commerce, government, and religion. One of the major centers of the Roman world. This city, the gateway to the entire province, gave Paul a strategic pulpit from which to spread God's word.
During the years that Paul spent in Ephesus, he did not cease evangelizing the other areas around. He formed other evangelists, those who would bear the gospel, to go up into the valley and that area.
But for Paul, success was never free of potential disaster. In Ephesus, Paul received distressing reports. Some Christian communities were foundering. In Corinth, a variety of moral and social issues were tearing apart the congregation. Sexual temptation, drunkenness at worship service, divorce, civil litigation. In a letter to church members, Paul strove to strengthen their faith by reminding them of the danger to be found in dissension.
Do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy that person.
What he's saying is that the unity of the church is more important than any of these things that are dividing you. Unity in the ancient world and in the modern world in the eyes of many as well is bought at the price of submission of some persons to the higher good.
Then, in what has become his most famous passage, Paul poetically described the supreme Christian value, love.
Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends.
Eventually, Paul's words tamed the savage beasts that threatened to tear his followers apart. Paul would stay and teach in Ephesus for 2 years, longer than any single place. And his impact on the early Christians there was immense. A mountaintop overlooking Ephesus. Inside, a grotto dating from perhaps as early as the 4th century. For ages, the interior of this cave has remained unseen to all but a handful of archaeologists. Now it is revealed to the world.